No, this is 7:45.
You probably don't know this, do you?
Three motions.
Oh, I thought you said personnel.
No.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I've got that list.
Perfect. Thank you.
Good.
We're ready.
Are we ready? Good evening. I call to order the meeting, the January 17th, 2017 meeting of the Washington County Board of Education. Declare a quorum. And at this time, I'd like to welcome a fifth grader from Potomac Heights Elementary School, Jaden Mason, who's going to lead us in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
Welcome, Jaden, and thank you for being here to lead us in the pledge this evening. Would you like to introduce the people that you've brought with you tonight?
This is my dad, this is my mom, and this is my brother, Walker.
And the gentleman in the pink shirt?
He is my principal.
He's your principal. Thank you for being here, Mr. Stark. Jaden, would you like to share some information with us this evening? We chatted a little bit earlier. Is there something you'd like to share with the board?
Well, one of my favorite hobbies is playing online with my friends on my console. I like to read, and I run with my dad and my mom and my brother, and with our dog. Oh.
So you're a family of runners?
Yeah.
Do you jog? Do you sprint?
We kind of are more of a long distance running family. Oh.
Where's your favorite place to run?
My favorite place to run is probably on the loop we do with our dog when we run with her.
Uh-huh. Do any of my colleagues have anything that they would like to ask of Jaden?
How about school, Jamie? What's your favorite subject?
My favorite subject is art.
Oh, cool.
Do you hope to do something in art one day eventually, when you grow up? Don't you know yet?
No, I don't really plan on doing anything with art. I just like drawing. And.
Very good.
I wanted to ask, what are your favorite books?
The book that I'm reading now is the first book in the Seekers collection. When I was young, like in second grade, I read the Magic Treehouse books.
Oh, yeah. That's when you were young, though.
Yeah.
Now that you're older, I got better taste.
Can I ask, what's your dog's name?
Roxy.
Roxy? And what kind of dog is she?
She's a breed between a wired hair terrier and a miniature poodle.
And she's a good runner?
Yep.
Outstanding. That's great. Thank you very much. And thank you for introducing your family to us. I don't know if your dad said this to you, but I saw him just the other night covering an event. So All right, thank you.
Thank you for being here, Jake. We'll move to the approval of the agenda. I have a motion for approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Thank you, Mr. Bickford. Do we have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Gasford. Discussion?
Madam President, excuse me. I move to amend the agenda under new business, the item entitled Superintendent Resignation.
Okay, so we're going to make a number 5 under new business, Superintendent's Resignation. Any other discussion? We'll move to the vote on the amendment. We're amending tonight's agenda to add a number 5 under new business, Superintendent's Resignation. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Okay, 2, we have 6-0. And
student concurs.
And the student concurs. Thank you, I always forget to say that. And we'll move on then to the approval of the amended agenda. Another motion.
So moved.
Thank you, Mr. Bickford.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Stauffer. Any discussion? Okay, the vote is on the agenda as amended. All those in favor? 6-0. Student member concurs. Okay, and now for the approval of the minutes.
Madam President, I move that we approve the first set of closed session minutes dated January 3rd, 2017.
Have a second.
Second.
Any discussion? Okay. All those in favor of accepting the minute? 6-0. Mr. Bickford?
Madam President, I move for approval of the second set of closed session minutes dated January 3rd, 2017.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? The vote is on the second set of closed session minutes. All those in favor? 6-0.
Madam President, I move for approval of the business meeting minutes dated January 3rd, 2017.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? All those in favor of approving the minutes of the business meeting January 3rd? 6-0. Okay. Thank you. And that brings us to public comment. We have no one signed up this evening. Is there anyone in the audience who didn't have the opportunity to sign up who would like to come forward to speak? No? Okay. We'll move right on then to the superintendent's report.
Thank you. It's my pleasure this evening to introduce representatives from the Barbara Ingram School for the Arts, BISFA as it's commonly called around the community. I would like to ask Mimi Dickinson, the executive director of the foundation, to come forward along with Al Martin, Steve Hummel, who is the treasurer of the organization, Al is the president, and Dr. Robert Hoppermill. I can't believe I did that after 5 years. Who is the principal at BISFA. Wow, that was so odd. I think it's because you look so clean shaven and just got so clean cut.
Oh, I get it now.
I didn't recognize you.
Thank you, Madam President, Dr. Wilcox, and board members for allowing us the time this evening to come in and speak with you. I believe that most of you have been through...
Could you move closer to the microphone? People in the audience are having a hard time hearing.
Oh, okay. Now I'm really loud.
Yeah.
Now I
be
feel
loud.
Like I'm on stage. I would like at this time to invite you to Barbara Ingram if you haven't been into the building and seen any of our productions. So tonight we wanted to invite you to the opening night of the musical, The Seussical. Invitations will be coming out, and you will be able to join us and see our all-school production that we have. That is our next fundraising event that the foundation is holding. Obviously, Dr. Wilcox introduced everybody, but at this time I wanted to turn it over to Al Martin, our president.
Thank you, Mimi. It's a pleasure to be here this evening. I know I've had the pleasure of serving as a volunteer with the Barbara Ingram School for the Arts Foundation Board since I retired 5 years ago from the city. And it was a great opportunity being when I was city finance director to work with the then school board and superintendent and staff, and seeing that wonderful magnet school for the arts open and to see it grow and thrive. It's hard to believe this coming year we'll be celebrating the 10th anniversary of the school, and great strides have been made. I'll let Rob just take a moment perhaps to talk a little bit about some of the academic and professional achievements of the students, but truly that small learning community has been a place where kids are passionate about being there, they want to be there, and they're doing very well. Not only are they excelling in their passion of the arts, but they're also excelling academically. And it's not just the, I'll just call it the exclusive elitist folks. I'm amazed when we look at the number of folks from homes that are benefiting from that opportunity. Free and reduced lunches make up what percentage of the population there, Rob?
It's about 27% right now.
So it's a significant percentage, and we're thrilled from a private foundation standpoint to be able to help to support the operation of the school. Annually, we're raising several hundred thousand dollars a year that's going back into enrichment grants and other things that are helping to support the students, as well as we're doing a summer arts academy that is not just for BISFA students, actually it's for the entire county, and an opportunity to expose kids throughout the county to the arts. What we're here, in addition to inviting you to the spring musical, is one of the ways that we've been able to collaborate as a private nonprofit is that we have had the superintendent serve as an ex officio member on our board, along with one member of the school board itself. And so Dr. Hardings was our representative to the school board. So we would ask that our bylaws call for that, and we would hope that you would see fit to have someone from the school board continue that relationship, because it's been a great way of collaborating and working together for the advancement of the school. So that's something that we'd like to request formally this evening. And again, just to thank you for your support in the past, for just making that very unique experiment and one of the first in the state be so successful, and I think such an asset for our community. Rob, do you want to talk a little bit about the academic achievement quickly?
Just to echo everything he just said about how thankful we are for this school. The school is set up for the arts. It's set up, students come in only in their art form. They audition through the art form. But our scores academically have shown that these students can excel when they pursue their passion. That's really what this school is all about. It really is a diverse school. And I would invite you to, anytime you want to come down, to please come down, just come in. The best thing about this school is to ask the kids. Talk to the kids. They will be completely honest with you. They'll tell you about their experiences. They'll tell you what they like. They'll tell you what they don't like. And they'll be very, very open and candid with you. So we would invite you to come down anytime you want. Just pick up the phone, give me a call, and we'll make sure that we're ready for you. We even get a space for you right out front if we can pull that off. So,
any questions for us this evening? Thank you again for your support. We certainly appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you for all the fine things that you do for our students and for all the great support that you give. Very appreciative of that. Colleagues, do you have any questions for this time?
I have so many questions. I don't know how the school operates at all now. I'm a little biased because my daughter went there, but I'm also biased because I was on the first year of the foundation and really saw it as an exciting organization to be involved in. That was back when we were still raising funds for the foundation through the Downtown Butterflies, and then later the hot air balloon. But it's been a thrill to have my daughter go there. She's since graduated. But I can attest to everything that Rob said. You know, she struggled in middle school and then ended up going to this school based on her audition, and ended up with a great GPA and got into a good college. So, you know, she's just one of many success stories. So thank you.
Well, just one thing before you go. I want to say that I have the privilege of sitting on this board, and to a person on the board, they're committed to not just the arts, but to the students, and to the students of the county. And I think oftentimes people lose sight of the fact that Barbara Ingram School is perhaps not the influence that it is. They lose sight of how influential it is. It's influential in a number of ways. One, I think it inspires kids to higher performance in their art forms. But number two, I think it shows that all kids can fit into an environment, and in many ways it's been the inspiration behind some of the learning community work that we've been trying to do in the district. It was the school that actually said to me some time ago, you know what, we can create a public service academy and let kids chase their passion in there as well. And I think it's similarly true that our kids that are now at the public service academy are also doing extremely well academically. It wouldn't happen without great people. You're seeing three really inspiring community leaders in front of us, Mimi Dickinson in particular. Mimi, I want to credit you because you work so hard behind the scenes to make this foundation what it is. I think all too often people don't realize that this isn't just a 40-hour job for Mimi. This is a way of life. And so I want to thank you for all you've done. You were one of the first voices that welcomed me to the community. You've been a consistent voice and champion for the arts, so thank you very much. And all of you know Rob Havermill, who was our director of fine arts, but is now probably one of the nation's leading principals in terms of leading a school for the fine arts. Rob, you do a great job. I will tell you that if it were possible for me to steal you away, you would be one of the people that I would take. But I understand your commitment to the community. I also understand that Al would hit me if I tried, so I'm not going to do that. But again, I want this board to know that this is a gem within this larger community, and quite frankly, it is such a well-run organization that it is the organization that I use when I see other groups who are trying to formulate kind of a support structure around kids. Talk to the Barbara Ingram Foundation Board because they know how to do it for kids. They know how to support the system. They know how to get things done. So I want to thank all of you for your work.
Thank you, Clayton.
Thank you.
And besides us, we have 20 other active members on our foundation board, as well as 5 other advisory board members. And we're just thrilled to be able to be part of a public-private partnership with the school system of helping to do great things for our community and the kids.
Thank you all.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
The second item of the superintendent's report is a report on the OnTrack Washington County program. Jim Kirchville, who is the executive director of Greater Hagerstown's committee, and Paul Fry, who is the president and CEO of the Washington County Chamber of Commerce, were here, and what I hope they will do is provide you some new information around this wonderful new initiative called OnTrack Washington County, but also extend just the courtesy of making sure that you have all the information that they have.
Thank you, Dr. Wilcox. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for having us here this evening to talk about first OnTrack, and we'll talk also about the Community Coalition. I'm Paul Fry, president of the Chamber, and it's our pleasure to be here. Jim Kirchville will talk about On Track, but before he does that, I just wanted to maybe state the obvious, but I think it's important why the Chamber and the business community is involved with both these initiatives. First of all, with On Track, you know, our mission is to foster, maintain a thriving business climate which our members and community can grow and prosper, and the private sector drives any community, but you cannot have a thriving business sector and a community without great public education. And so we see this as a natural partnership. When I came on board the Chamber a little more than 2 years ago, we didn't really have representation from public school on our board, and Dr. Wilcox, when he was asked to serve on the board, he graciously said yes, and we saw that as a great connection for us. And we work really hard for business solutions, including providing access to education expertise. We do want to be a resource for solutions, and we think partnership is important. We think this is a workforce development issue, because if we don't have educated students coming to either go to college or go into a career, businesses won't locate here and families won't locate here. So with that, Jim's going to talk about the On Track, and then when he's finished and with your questions, then we'll go on to the coalition. Jim?
Good evening, everyone. Thanks for having us today. As Paul said, I'm going to go over, if we could start the PowerPoint, I'm going to go over a few slides.
I think you can if
it's good. Okay. So we're going to go over a few slides. I got a little bit of data to show you, which was kind of some of the things that inspired our organization to start looking at some initiatives and ways we could help with workforce development. And then we'll give you a little overview of On Track. This is usually a longer program when I do bigger groups, but if anybody has more questions or like for us to meet with us down the road, we're happy to sit and talk with you at a later time. As Paul said, I think one of the early things that we are noticing is some workforce shortages in a few specific industries in our county, but nationwide, this has been a growing problem. In some of the research we've done, they're projecting 5 million, I've heard anywhere from 5 million to 9 million of skilled workers that are going to be needed across the country, and we are not producing enough degree learners or vocationally trained learners to fill those positions. So here is a chart that we use a lot in some of our presentations to talk about job hirings versus job openings. And for the first time in decades, you could see that the number of job openings is outpacing the number of job hirings. And again, it's showing that we're starting to fall into a labor crunch versus an excess labor amount that we had back in the 07 recession times. Another area that we have some concerns over is when you're looking at technology. Technology's great, it's growing, but it also tends to replace certain industries and certain types of jobs out there. This is an article by Fortune magazine, which talks about some of the jobs most likely to be replaced, things like telemarketers, cashiers, tellers, retail people, carpenters, truck drivers, medical service personnel, real estate sales, things like that. If you look at that list and line that up with the top 20 industries in Washington County, there's a lot of similarities there. So we need to be aware of that, knowing that some of those jobs are going to be, technology is going to working them down over time, and we need to figure out how to bring the jobs in to replace those. Here's another slide that kind of, I think, helps explain to people who wonder why, hey, 30, 40 years ago, things were fine here. Why has that changed? But if you look at the chart in your upper right, back in the 1970s, about three quarters of the jobs in this country only required a high school degree. Many of those were good paths into the middle class. What they're projecting for 2020 is that's going to drop down to only 36%, or a little over a third of the jobs in this country are going to require a high school degree or less. The majority of the jobs are going to require some sort of college or two-year training in one of the trades. If you look down in the lower left, you'll see Washington County stats. Those are 2014 stats. We're just in the process of updating our report card for this year with the newer data. But you can see where we are in regard to the percent of jobs that are going to be required in the economy that take a master's, bachelor's, or AA degree, and how Washington County, as well as many parts of this country, are below those numbers. So, you know, what do we need to do as a community to try to jumpstart the amount of degreed learners that we are producing? The Lumina Foundation is a national foundation that we came across very early in this process, who are they are working solely to promote this issue across the country with our federal leaders as well as across the different states. They have a goal of 2025 that they want 60% of the population to have some either a two-year degree or better, or a quality vocational certificate, you know, something in the trades. They're projecting that 65% of the jobs will require at least some form of post-secondary education by 2020. Many of those are going to be a bachelor's degree, about 30%. 90% of the fastest growing jobs in this country require at least an AA degree. And 80% of all jobs will be requiring more than a high school diploma. So again, there's a lot of different groups out there, and they're all seeing the same things when they're looking at the market. This chart here sums up, is related to the Lumina Foundation goal, which is at 60%. That's the yellow line going across the top. That is where we want to be by 2025. You can see Washington County is down in the purple, only at 33.9%. So we really almost have to double our numbers over the next 10 years. If you look at the current rate of growth in the next 10 years, we're probably only going to be around 40%, 41% if we grow at the rate we've been growing. And we're moving forward, and that's a good thing, but we're just not going at the pace we need to do. So we're going to have to figure out how do we jumpstart that. The next chart kind of gives you a little more specifics there, and I won't go into all those details, but you could look at each the growth of each of our different levels, from the high school graduate to associate's degree, bachelor's degree or higher. And you know, when you look at all that together, we're growing at about 0.75% a year. And again, we need to grow at about triple that rate to get up to the 60% level. Here's a collection of charts which talks about college enrollment in the county and where we're at. And again, as you can see, that is moving up slightly, but it still shows the same type of things. We have more females enrolling in college than males. One of the big discrepancies you see in point difference is over to the right. The free and reduced meal students are about 27 points less, are about 20 points less than the regular students when we're enrolling into college. And how do we increase that? Because of our population, we know about half of our students fall into that category. So a lot of that data is what our organization, the Greater Hagerstown Committee, kind of was looking at, and we wanted to see how do we do something to help bring the community together and involved in moving things forward. We wanted to build a coalition. We understood that, you know, when you look at the data, the school system, as we said, is doing a lot of great things. We certainly applaud you all for just what you announced last week with HCC, the Promise Pathway Program. What a great program that is going to be, and that fits right into what we're trying to do as another step in helping, you know, a select group of students improve. But, you know, you need the whole community support if we're going to triple our rate of degree learners we're producing and to really move that number forward. We looked across the country at some other type of initiatives out there, and we came across the Strive Together organization. This was done in Cincinnati, Ohio. They have a template. Everything's a little different, specific to each county out there around the country, but they have a template they like to follow. They have 68 different networks in 32 different states where they have these type of cradle-to-career networks set up, these community coalitions. In Maryland, there's one other one other than us, and that's the Baltimore Promise that just opened several years ago. Maryland, we are the second one in Maryland to try to move through the Strive Together program. One of the things we liked about the Strive Together program is it had some success. Let's see here, moving next slide. In the first 4 years in Cincinnati, Strive Together saw a 9% increase in kindergarten readiness. I think you all are very familiar with those numbers and the challenges we have there. That's a significant jump in just 5 years by bringing the community together. They had 11% increase in high school graduation. When we look at some of these promise programs, or not promise programs, but these cradle career initiatives around the state, high school graduation is a big issue for a lot of communities. Again, I applaud the school system here because that is not necessarily one of the things we focus on as a challenge. We certainly would love to have 100% graduation, but at 92, 93% where we are, that's really high marks when we look at the rest of the country. They had a 10% increase in college enrollment when they started as well. Over the course of the 9-year history, 91% of the student outcome indicators that they looked at improved. Kindergarten readiness continued to jump up. It's now at 75%. And, you know, while their kindergarten readiness stat may not be apples to apples to Maryland's, it just gives you an idea. It's close, and you could see that big jump. And we would certainly love to be at 75%, you know, 9 years from now, if not sooner. Fourth grade reading was also an area that improved. That was one of the benchmarks that a lot of these groups look at. From kindergarten to third grade, you learn to read. But from fourth grade on, you read to learn. So all the different classes and curriculums require reading as part of the problem solving. And if you're behind in third grade, you're going to struggle in all your different classwork. So that's another area they focus on. Here's an example of the things they put together for their community. This is the Strive Partnership, which is actually the entity in Cincinnati that's working. But what they do is they pick specific group of benchmarks. Here they have kindergarten readiness, fourth grade reading, post-secondary enrollment. And they show the goal that they're set, and they're setting a goal in 2020, and where they go each year, what the rate of improvement is, and are they at the rate they need. So these are things that we're trying to track to bring the community's attention on where these areas we need to focus on, and also try to bring the resources from many different stakeholders within our community to try to how can they join in with the school system, with our other post-secondary educational partners to move things forward. So what OnTrack did is we tried to pull together a coalition. We have 33 different local stakeholder groups. We have some of those out here today. You want a couple raise your hand? I do. I will say we told a lot of the group to come out around 6:30 or so, so we're running a little ahead of schedule, so we may be passing some in the hall as we finish up. But there are 33 different groups. All the post-secondary entities are involved, HCC, University System Maryland. Butch is here from the Pittsburgh Institute of Aeronautics, from the trade side. We have a lot of early childhood groups, the United Way, the Chamber of Commerce, YMCA, a lot of organizations work directly with kids every day. We're trying to get them all together to try to look at this issue and how can we work together as a community to improve things. Our vision is that every person in Washington County is prepared to thrive in a 21st century workforce, producing self-reliant and engaged individuals who strengthen our local economy and community. I think that aligns very closely with what the school system's vision is. I think that's all plus that we're all on the same page there. Our mission, again, is to take the public, private, nonprofit resources and opportunities that we have in our community, align them from cradle to career, and try to empower individuals to maximize their potential through educational and vocational endeavors. What these groups found as they were working around the country is that you can't wait till they get into high school to start preaching, okay, we need to get you college ready or we need to get you in the trades. You have to work with kids from the very beginning because kids that are not ready at kindergarten level, they're going to struggle more and you have less likely to get them to enroll in college down the road. So you got to put some resources there to get them up to speed. You got to kind of look at that whole path, and along the way, there's key areas you want to try to work on to try to move forward. So what we hope to do is help facilitate a community vision and agenda for college and career readiness. We want to define and articulate some of these challenges that we talked about today in our community and in our country and try to get the community together to move those forward. We want to come up with some unified shared measurements and benchmarks that all the different partners agree on and try to track our progress and move those forward and then be transparent with the public on where we're at and try to move those along. And then we want to encourage and facilitate collaborations and strategic action among our different partner groups that are out there and try to move this forward. We've learned that if a couple work together, like you all broke down one of the barriers for financial aid when it comes to college, going to college for HCC by two getting together. We've come up with some other partnerships, particularly in the early childhood level. For example, we're talking with the pediatric community about when they're meeting with parents on wellness visits for kids that typically look at height and weight and things like that, can we bring in those cognitive benchmarks as well and create a booklet that the ECAC is already putting together? We have one that's we're going to try to put out there for print, but put out a booklet, share it with parents, and teach them, here's some of the things you could do with a one-year-old, with a two-year-old, with a three-year-old to help them be more kindergarten ready when they come in. So again, trying to look at all those different groups of the community, bring them together, look at the problems, and how can we solve these problems together is what we're trying to do. Just to give you an idea of how we're structured and how we would like to be structured, this is ultimately what our organizational chart's going to look like. We have the OnTrack leadership team, which is basically a representative from each of our 33 partners. That we call the active partners group. What we did is we break down into three different subgroups. We have early childhood, school-age youth, and workforce career. They try to look at the data and the challenges in those specific age ranges from birth to third grade as early childhood, from third grade to graduation high school as school-age youth, and then outside of that is workforce career. There is some overlap between those subgroups, you know, as far as age ranges, but we felt that's the best way to break down the big problem, look and try to come up with ways we can make things better. In the end, it's the active partner groups that actually do the projects. OnTrack is more as a facilitator. It's the umbrella that kind of looks over things. We are not a top-down organization where those active partners have to, you know, we tell them what to do or act up. What we try to do, the OnTrack Coalition tries to do, is just highlight the issues, put out some ideas for solving some of those problems, and then the active partners independently decide what they want to put their resources to that fits their mission and their goals. So it's more of just trying to get everybody in the same room to talk about some of the challenges we face. What we're working towards right now is to hire a full-time executive director. We've been doing this on a volunteer basis for about a year and a half, 2 years to get things organized. There is a kind of wave of momentum and support that we're getting out there, but there's really a lot more that needs done, and it needs a full-time effort, a full-time director. I've been filling in for the Greater Hagerstown Committee. That's unusual for our group to kind of take on a project, but we felt so strongly about this one, we knew we needed to kind of prop it up and support it. So I try to fit that in with some of my other work obligations, and we made a lot of progress thanks to a lot of very good, committed people in the active partner groups. And I applaud the school system. We have several members, and some of them are in the room back here, Matt, others, that have been regularly involved in our meetings and really do a lot to help move some things forward. And we greatly appreciate that. This is my last slide here, which kind of talks about, we've probably for the last year, we've looked at what are the major issues we want to work on and we need to help. One thing's not mentioned in this slide that all three groups said is we really need a strong community marketing effort. We need to educate the community on the new economy is going to require a different type of workforce. We need to get ourselves set up for that. Here's how you do it. You know, here's some things we need to do and bring that forward. So all three groups are going to have a marketing component to try to do a lot of outreach. But we're going to work. We felt most of the need that we need to put resources into, again, is early childhood development, you know, pre-K. Can we get more into public pre-K over time? Can we take the existing pre-K entities out there and help give them some resources or some curriculum that they could use that's more in line with what the school system uses, that has a little bit higher quality? Can we educate parents on the need to, you know, look for, you know, invest wisely in your child care because it has a big impact in your child's development once they move forward. It's not something you just want to kind of put them in front of the TV and let them watch Sesame Street for a while. So those are some of the things for early childhood development. Kindergarten readiness falls into that. We talked about the reading at grade level, third grade, as well as the others. Try to keep our reading scores up, encourage reading programs outside of the school, inside the school. Introduction to STEM in early age, that gets involved with, you know, math and sciences is where a lot of these new positions are going to come from. So how can we get kids excited about that? How can we expose them to those things, you know, early on to get them interested? College and career path connections, this is a big one. You know, Paul, and this is why it's great to have the Chamber as being the host agency for this initiative, is they understand workforce development is going to be the key to having a strong economy up here. And we're going to be able to work with the business community to kind of help with creating some of those career path and connections and educating students on what they need to do. North High last year did a pilot program that came out of some of the work through the EDC's Workforce Development Group. That was one of the active partners that came with this idea. Bob Jeffers and his team at that time, they went to North High. They got company representatives from all the different 12 industries in Maryland. Maryland breaks down all the jobs into 12 different categories. So we tried to get employees and business owners in each category to come into the school for a half a day. High school students from, I believe it was ninth grade on, all participated. They came in and they got to sit down and talk to people that are actually working in those fields. And those people were able to say, here's what I love about my job. Here's some of the challenges about my job. Here's the education it required, or here is the vocational training it was required. They let the kids know that, hey, you really, if you could come in with just an AA degree, my company paid for my bachelor's and then helped pay for my other education, so you don't feel you have to knock all that off at once. You know, the kids were able to see firsthand what it means to be in that position and how to work up to it. Those are some of the things we'd like to replicate in every high school. Jim Alshire did a great job at setting that up, putting together a template that was very successful. They even did a survey with the kids afterwards with their iPads to let them know how we did, and we had some really strong marks that came back, not only from the kids, but the business owners that participated were really engaged and excited about having that opportunity to share what they do every day with the kids. So there is a 40-minute program. They tried to break down about 15, and I just wanted to give you that overview. I will say that we wanted to kind of give you this overview today and let you know what we're doing. And the school system has been, you know, probably our most active partner, and you certainly are engaged in a big part of that cradle to career timeline there from pre-K up through 12th grade, which explains a lot of that. But we certainly appreciate that. We would like to come and talk to the board later time about some support for the executive director. We're out there now raising money. We got a grant from AT&T that I believe some of you were at Bester Elementary in October when the governor came up for his cabinet. AT&T gave us $25,000 to support this program to get it off the ground. We're very grateful for that. We've had strong support from City. They were actually our first sponsor that helped create our logo and our website. We do have a website out there. It's ontrackwc.org that has some more information, too, if you'd like to see. And with that, if there's any questions or anything.
Colleagues have questions or comments for Mr. Kirchhoff? Additional information available at the website?
Additional information is available at your website, and we gave you some handouts that also talked a little bit about a summary and some of the things we're working on.
So if I were interested in becoming involved in helping with getting kids reading one grade level, I could find some information on that website.
I think there is some information on that right now, but that's a work in progress. We are very new. So we do have, there's a blog section that we have some different things on. Again, it goes back to why we're looking for that full-time staff to try to put together things. Eventually, we'd like to upgrade the website to be a little more complex, a little more user-friendly, where we would have a section just for early childhood and reading, a place to share. I think one reason we spent some money in building the brand and the logo is over time, we hope that this brand becomes a trusted source of information from the whole different spectrum, from early childhood development to college enrollment, where parents and families and students can go and try to get some information and updates, share activities and events. That's down the road.
Down the road.
We are a new entity that's just trying to get going.
Great. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
That's the On Track piece. And we'll segue here into the Community Coalition. There are some tie-ins with some of the work we're doing with the two entities. What I wanted to do is Jim mentioned the mission statement of WCPS, how it ties into On Track, and how it moves us, hopefully, into the coalition. And the mission statement on the website is Washington County Public Schools, in partnership with community members, again, the word partnership, educates and enables all students to fully access opportunities afforded them in a rapidly changing, diverse, and global society. So again, that reinforces what we're trying to do with On Track. We think the missions align, and we look forward to working together with you on that. And speaking of partnership, the Community Coalition is another great example of partnership in Washington County. I think you have some materials. We gave you some of the background. Started in 2005, it was driven out of the need to go to Annapolis with one voice. What many of us learn over time, and maybe you already know, is the other legislators in Annapolis want us to come together as a legislative body from Washington County with one voice. It makes it easier for them to support our needs. And, you know, again, why the chamber is involved as one of the now 9 partners is as the voice of business, we want to shape and influence public policy to benefit business and community, again, the word community, and then monitor key issues of concern to business. So we're one of 9 partners this year, and I think in your paperwork you'll see the City of Hagerstown, Washington County Public Schools, Greater Hagerstown Committee, Washington County Free Library, the Chamber of Commerce, of course, the Convention and Visitors Bureau, Chief, and this year Williamsport is joining us as well, and Washington County Government. And so every year we come up with initiatives, and the focus is on what do we need as a community. And not every entity is 100% represented every year, but it's a team effort, and we think what's good for one entity helps Washington County. Over the years, we've worked together to protect some money and also bring some money with initiatives. So this starts usually in the summer. We meet as an organization. All the partners come together. We meet, say, what are the initiatives we need to highlight this year? We work with our legislators here in the area. We get them involved. We work with the city and the county government to make sure we're on the same wavelength. So we work through the summer, we create an agenda, then we meet over the next few months into September and October to finalize that agenda. We get the partners together and make sure we don't miss anything. And then we put together an agenda and bring it forward to the General Assembly. Now, part of this work that's also benefits Washington County is our reception we have every year, the day in Annapolis for Washington County. This year, it's on February 1st. All of you are welcome to attend. And we have about 25 or so folks representing Washington County that have display tables to talk about their initiatives. PIA is there, Volvo is there, Capital University is there. And I will say that the favorite among the group is Washington County Public Schools. We have students that come and they wow these legislators, these 16, 17, 18-year-olds. I remember last year they were talking about how easy it is to hack into your information to get the personal information, and they actually demonstrate how to do it. This year we're going to have folks representing biomed, the gaming and cybersecurity, computer repair. And again, they're very professional. They represent not only the school system well, but their area of expertise. So that's part of letting the folks who don't get to Washington County, the legislators who are down south or Montgomery County, they just don't make their way up here, educate them about Washington County and the good things we're doing. Through our work with the coalition and working with our lobbyists, because they can help us with these relationships, we had the Appropriations Committee come up here this past summer, which is unheard of almost for them to make the trip to Washington County. We had almost the whole committee, and we talked about what we're trying to do in Washington County, including we toured through Barbara Ingram School. We also toured Maryland Theater, showed them this urban improvement project, and as you can imagine, they were highly impressed with Barbara Ingram School. They saw the students in action. They saw the work being done, and as well as the Maryland Theater, and we emphasized this is where the money you're giving back to us in Washington County is going to work. It's invested well. It's got great return on investment. And so they're highly impressed. And again, that's part of the work of the coalition. Now, over the years, we've protected about $22 million in revenues that maybe could have gone another way. And what we've brought to Washington County over the years since 2005 is about $46 million, including most recently, this year was announced, $7 million for the Barbara Ingram School and the Urban Improvement Project. The governor's allocated that in his budget, as well as $5 million for I-81. So we think it's a great investment of our time and energy. Again, partnering with the school system and the other folks working with us, it's one voice and what's good for Washington County. We're excited about this year. Again, we have, I think in your packet, we have our agenda in there. I-81 leads the way, as it has been, and we hope that we'll also get a commitment down the road to continue widening that stretch over the next 10 years so that we get that work done.
Well, another, is this year's packet, or is it a year, a previous year's packet? Because there's some information that's dated in here.
What I handed out today, we are in the process of putting together last year's packet. The packet you have in your thing is just one. We wanted to give you that to show you an example of the information that's put together by the coalition. This is what we give out to all the members that go down. There's a big section that talks about kind of how to navigate, you know, how the structure of Annapolis is, how it works, how to navigate it, how build process works. Then we go into our agenda, then we go into the reception in the back. We have what's called a legislator packet, which is that same booklet without all the informational material that we also give out to legislators. So when we meet with them, we'll have big group meetings where the legislators come in and talk to 30. Well, actually, we'll have 40 to 60 people because Leadership Maryland or Leadership Washington County joins us for those meetings as well that day. But they'll come in and talk to us. And then we also try to set up small group, you know, three or four, meeting with one specific delegate, senator, or person from the administration. We use the booklets as a way to kind of educate them on the issues.
So the day for the coalition day is Monday, February 1st, not Thursday.
Yes, that was last year.
Wednesday, February 1st.
Wednesday, February 1st is the day of the coalition.
And we'll get the information out. We're going to have our final meeting before the 25th. We'll make sure you have that information. And as I said, the board members are welcome to attend as a partner. One of the key initiatives this year is the Urban Improvement Project. Again, the county, city, the Board of Education, Maryland Theater.
USMH.
USMH. as well as private sector, working together for this huge project. And again, we brought the Appropriations Committee down in the summer to show them that. And as you've heard, the governor's putting his budget some monies towards that. That's one of our initiatives. And part of this is educating the other legislators not from the area what we're doing. We meet with some key leadership in the Senate and also on the House side to, number one, put a face to what we're doing. And we make a very good impression as a community. And we get accolades for coming down with one voice representing the community. And so as we've talked about working in partnership with the On Track program, we want to also continue working in partnership with the school system. For instance, you know, this is actually what was printed, and that was on behalf of the school system as part of their partnering with us. Last year, the city puts it together, and then the school system puts it together and represents, I think, the community well with what we're trying to accomplish. And I know a number of folks, a number of board members wanted to know more information about this coalition, and so sometimes less is more for talking. And so if you have specific questions, we'd love to address them, and any missing pieces in your mind or suggestions or concerns, we'd love to hear them and see if we can address them.
Colleagues, do you have some questions for Mr. Fry? This time, I would like an opportunity to really study the material, look over the material, and I can see that I would have some questions in the future. I appreciate the invitations that I've received via email to attend the coalition meetings. I've not been able to do that, but I will certainly make the effort to come and...
We understand, you know, with elected officials, you guys have meetings after meetings after meetings. One of the reasons we keep you on the distribution list is just so you could see the minutes and, you know, if you want to keep you up to speed on what's going on. What we like to have each year is at least one representative from each of the partners to attend the meeting, whether that's staff or whether that's elected official. And then their job then would be to come back and keep everybody, you know, informed with what's going on. Yeah, again, we brainstorm in the summer, but then over the fall, we try to narrow things down. And ultimately, what we want to get is five or six items that everybody has full agreement on. If there's an item that one of the partners likes, but the other one said, no, I'm not for that, then we just push that one out. And, you know, it's, you could still lobby those on your own. You know, that may be fine. But for the community coalition, it wants to be a group of agenda items that everybody agrees to. And that makes it easier to get that funding, as Paul said. There is one other component to this that you'll notice in, you know, if you look at the paperwork I sent, not in the booklet I handed out, but the other paperwork, we have what's called a watch list. And what we do with our lobbyists, we talk to them about several things that are very important to us. And you'll notice there's two on there in regard to education. The Kerwin Commission, which is the, you know, Thornton II, the educational funding for the future. And then the 21st Century School Construction Commission. So we've asked our lobbyists to keep a close eye on that, particularly how that may impact rural counties. And if he sees any kind of challenges there, then what they do is they're like, it's like a tripwire. They will contact us and let us know, hey, there's a new amendment that's being talked about coming out, or here's some new things coming. And the quicker we can react to that, the better you have to keep bad things from happening or help good things get put into a bill. A good example was several years ago now, but there was an attack on the gaming money in Washington County, the tip jar issue. And we were able to kind of learn very early on that, you know, there was a bill that was put in that was going to try to get everything to flow to the state, where we'd lose that local control through our gaming commission to allocate the funds to nonprofits. And we were able to rally the troops, so to speak, and we had phone calls and faxes going into the committee chairs to where, you know, they went to our local delegation members, said, hey, can you just call that off? We get the point that we're going to rethink some things. And, you know, that's all about being in the know. And unfortunately, in Annapolis, it's a cloudy, complicated, fast-moving system. You know, the rules kind of change a lot. You have 4,000 bills floating out. And what we found for us to be effective as a county is you need that professional, which is in the form of our lobbyists, who's down there working with things. I know you all hire artists specific to the educational needs, and our lobbyist is there to work closely with them as well. So they communicate when they're down there. If there's some issue that comes up, he knows to call Ardith to maybe get some details, or, you know, vice versa on some things there.
And the fact of the matter is, you know, politics aside, we have a Republican governor, our delegation is Republican, mm-hmm. And our lobbyist is in close with Miller and Bush. And so we have, we think, a multi-pronged approach. We have great contacts. We have great relationships. And again, it's about Washington County. And we try to put politics aside, and we try to access the resources we need. And we think we've got it covered. And again, it's about what's best for Washington County, working in partnership. And anytime you have questions, concerns, suggestions, the beauty about the On Track and the partners and the coalition, it sounds hokey, but we do work well together. We might have different opinions, but if we focus on what we're trying to do for the community, all the other stuff just goes by the wayside. And so we're excited about that, and we think we have another good year in store for us.
I just like to say this. Three of us were invited to the Hagerstown Rotary Club to answer questions one day during the campaign. And one of the members asked us a question about the On Track program. None of the three of us who were there knew about it. We kind of got chastised by the questioner about that. So after the meeting was over, there were about eight people sitting at your table. And two of the gentlemen, former students of mine, came up. And I said to them, I said, what the heck is the On Track program? And they said, we didn't know. They said there were eight of them, of you sitting at the table. And they said, the only one that knew was Paul Fry.
And that's good. I'll say that's good. And, at least I do.
And so I will say this. One is, and I won't mention their names, but one is been very active in community affairs for years. And the other gentleman is involved in county government. And no one knew. So, you know, is the word getting out there about your
On Track program? A lot going
on.
And to Jim's point earlier, everyone's busy, and that's part of what we're trying to do. And that's
let me just say that, you know, one of the reasons the word's not getting out there is, you know, we were still trying to put it together. So, I mean, I had a restaurant. Mike will understand this. When you open up the first day, you don't put up and say grand opening. You wait till you're in business for a week or two so you get some of the bugs worked out. One thing we were hoping to do is have an executive director by this time where we wanted to do a much more public unveiling of the effort. So we have reached out on a limited basis to try to let people know what's going on. We want to go on the talking circuit and move through that. But what we really hoped is we would have a face of the organization being the director that is out there starting that conversation. Not, you know, my face has been out there for a lot of different things, and, you know, we could do a lot better than that. So if we get a new director to put in place, that was what we were hoping to do. So
On Track is not a long time existing program.
We've been doing a lot of the kind of the groundwork, and there's been a lot of work going on for about a year and a half, but it's really more internal and trying to look at the data. We put the website out there so that if somebody did ask about it, we at least had some source that people could see. But we haven't made that concerted effort to really do the public unveiling. Again, we had planned to do that on the 27th of this month, and we decided we have a new board of directors that was just put in place, an executive board back in November. They decided to try to wait till February or March. We have some funding issues we're trying to work through. If we get it, we're really hoping for that first big public splash to be with the face of a new director. And we got some funding things we're working on now.
Like any other product, you can have a great product. If people don't know about it, you can't sell it and you can't talk about it. So to your point, we're working on that. And that's the other reason for the executive director search. We need a face and a voice out there in the community just beating on it. And, you know, the old saying, early to bed, early to rise, work like heck and advertise. So we have to be able to promote it.
Right.
And we're really close, and the great thing is we have some good partners. We have a great product to promote, and there's so many messages out there on so many things, and we just have to keep potting through that. So to your point, we're working on it, and again, we appreciate the opportunity to tell you about it today. And that's right. Any other questions you have, we just certainly want to hear from you.
I wasn't being critical.
No. We're not being critical. No.
The governor came up in October. We had that opportunity, and we're like, well, we got to take advantage of the governor in town. And he was happy to hand out some On Track T-shirts to the class, but kind of laughed because he walked into the third grade class who happened to be taught by one of my first employees, Jennifer Swartz, at the time, and she's married now. But when he walked in, he goes to the class. He goes, how many of you all know about On Track? And they all went, yay, we all do it. I'm thinking, nah, none of them. they just like the colorful T-shirt. They had added that up. But you know, we hope that On Track is a household name in the next couple years, okay. And that's what we're going to promote.
They also thought they were all going to get a T-shirt.
Yeah. They all did. This was
the
third grade class. Yeah. Third grade, they all got it. We went to the big room. We only had a few.
Well, whatever we can do to help create the buzz. I know that the day at Fountainhead Country Club that Mr. Ridenour was talking about, at least three people left that meeting wondering, oh, what is this about and where do I find out information? And so there were three of us who left very curious and wanting to know more.
And we were, that's one of the reasons we reached out to kind of say, come in and give you kind of the heads up.
But when the questioner asked the question, it was like, what do you think of the school systems program of Called On Track? And I'm thinking, I never knew the school system had a program called that. And it was a turn. I called Mr. Wright to ask him, what is it?
Well, anyway, we hope we helped you a little bit today and kind of undo that. If you'd like a lot of data, I could bore you to death on data. We can some of that, Ed. But we're happy to meet with you outside if you'd like to talk a little more.
Thank you so very much for coming this evening. Appreciate it. Okay. Next item on the agenda is old business, and there is none, so we'll move on to new business. And the first item of new business, Mr. Semler, good evening. First item of new business is a donation from Fountain Rock Elementary's PTA.
Good evening, President Williams, Dr. Wilcox, members of the board. Tonight, I'm seeking your approval for a gift in the amount of $15,000 from the Fountain Rock PTA to Fountain Rock Elementary School. The funds will be used to purchase and construct a pavilion that will be used for outdoor learning opportunities as well as other school-based activities and events.
Okay. Have a motion.
Madam President, I move to approve a donation in the amount of $15,000 from Fountain Rock Elementary PTA to Fountain Rock Elementary School.
Thank you, Mr. Fisher. Mrs. Fisher, sorry. Thank you, Mrs. Fisher. Is there a second, please?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Stauffer. Discussion? Questions for Mr. Semler? Okay. We'll move to the vote. The vote is on the approval of a donation in the amount of $15,000 from Fountain Rock Elementary PTA to Fountain Rock Elementary School. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Okay, 6-0 with the student member concurring.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, and please thank Fountain Rock's PTA for their generous contribution to the school.
I will.
Thank you. Okay, that brings us to our second item of new business, which is the board's approval of the recommended standing committee assignments. And what I'm going to read as the slate of assignments has a change from what you have. So as I read, please note, the standing committee assignments for 2017 being recommended: curriculum instruction, Karen Harshman as chairperson, Jacqueline Fisher as member, Wayne Ridenour as member. Facilities Committee, Michael Gesford as chairman, Stan Stauffer as member, Karen Harshman as member. Finance Committee, Peter Bickford as chairman, Melissa Williams as member, and Stan Stauffer as member. Human Resources Committee, Wayne Ridenour as chairman, Peter Bickford as member, Michael Gesford as member. Policy Committee, Jacqueline Fisher as chairwoman, Stan Stauffer as member, Melissa Williams as member. Those are the recommendations for standing committee assignments. Is there a motion?
Madam President, I move for board approval of the recommended standing committee assignments.
Thank you, Mr. Stauffer. Thank you, Mr. Gesford. Is there some discussion? Questions?
Madam President, I'm not sure how to do this, but I would like to add one. It's not a standing committee, but it is I'd like a consideration to have Mr. Bickford be our liaison to the Barbara Ingram Foundation. Yeah. And I think maybe we could add this to that if everybody's comfortable with that.
So can we add that as an amendment to the motion?
I'd be more than happy to ask
Okay.
ask it as an amendment. I move that we add the name of Mr. Peter Bickford to the list of individuals to serve on the Barbara Ingram School for the Arts Foundation as our liaison.
Okay. So the amendment then is to add Peter Bickford as the liaison to the Barbara Ingram Foundation. Is there a second to the amendment?
Second.
Behave.
I'm sorry, what was that?
I told Mr. Bickford he had to behave.
Yeah.
The amendment is Mr. Ridenour's, the second is Mrs. Fisher. We'll have a vote on the amendment, which is to add Mr. Peter Bickford as the liaison. All those in favor? 6-0. Student concurs. And that brings us back to the original motion for approval of the standing committee assignments.
We can't, she can't vote on this.
She can't vote on this one because this is personnel, correct? Okay, so.
So she abstained.
Are we ready for the vote? All those in favor of the standing committee assignments, 6-0.
Madam President, can I?
Yes.
Make a comment. I had talked with the president earlier today. I'm working on a schedule for the committees to meet. If any of the chairs have a particular time slot they think they would prefer, otherwise I'm going to try and make it so that since you're on two committees, if possible, the committees will, one will follow the other, so you won't have to wait around an hour or two until your next committee meeting. So I will try and get that into the email maybe tomorrow for you all to check out and see if you agree with it.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Fisher. Appreciate your help with that. Okay, we'll move on to the third item of new business, which is consideration of legislative response team members for 2017. We have the possibility of adding two members to our legislative response team. We'd like to have at least one. If there's anyone interested in serving on the legislative response team, would you so indicate an interest? Anyone interested?
I think Mrs. Harshman said that she was interested in doing that.
Okay, so we have Mrs. Harshman. Anyone else interested?
Did we skip something?
Yeah. Pardon?
I think we skipped one, Madam President. I apologize, but
we skipped one.
The Maryland Association of Boards of Education nominations for
that's the next one down. We just did standing committees and we're on legislative response team. Are they out of order on yours? Oh, I'm sorry.
They're
showing up as three and four on here.
I'm looking on the inline, so okay, it doesn't matter.
That's right. It's the difference between what's on the screen and what's on the paper.
Amazing.
What do you have? Do you have it as number three?
Where I have it the way you have it.
Okay.
Yeah, I have it as
you're my president.
Three.
Okay.
Yeah.
Whatever you say.
Okay, so would someone like to place a nomination, a board member
I'll move to approve board member Karen Harshman to serve as on the legislative response team.
Thank you, Mr. Gesford. Is there a second?
Second.
Dan? Okay, so the motion is to approve Karen Harshman as a member of the legislative response team. All those in favor? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Thank you, 6-0. No other interested members, no other takers?
I'll volunteer.
You'll volunteer?
Yeah.
All right, would someone like to make a motion to place Mr. Stauffer's name in
I'll move to approve board member Stan Stauffer to serve on the legislative response team.
Thank you, Mr. Gesford. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Bickford. All those in favor of adding Stan Stauffer to the legislative response team? Okay. Are you voting for yourself, sir?
No.
You're not? Thank you. Right. 6-0.
I don't like to do that.
Okay, so now we're at what is number four for some and number three for others, which is the Maryland Association Boards of Education Committee nominations. We need someone, it's asked by MABE that each county have someone serve on their budget committee. And the budget committee has met in the fall, but there is the possibility of a February meeting. And so it would be a good thing to have someone from our board at that meeting in February. I think it's, I want to say it's the 3rd, but I'm not certain. There is also an opening on the legislative committee. So do you have any interest in either of those?
I guess the chair of finance, I'll volunteer for budget.
For budget? Okay, we have Mr. Bickford. So would someone like to place Mr. Bickford's name in nomination for the budget committee?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, I'll take Mr. Stauffer for that. All those in favor of Mr. Peter Bickford serving as our representative on the MABE budget committee? Okay, 6-0. And if no one else is interested in serving as the representative on the legislative committee, I will volunteer to do that if someone would like to.
I'll move to nominate you, Mrs. Williams, to be our representative on the MABE legislative committee.
Thank you. Thank you. All those in favor of Melissa Williams serving as the board's representative on the MABE legislative committee? 6-0. Thank you. And that then brings us to number 5, which is the superintendent's resignation.
Madam President, I move to accept the resignation recently tendered by our superintendent, Dr. Clayton Wilcox, effective as of March 13th, 2017.
Thank you, Mr. Ridenour. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Stauffer. Is there any discussion?
Reluctantly.
What's that?
Reluctantly.
Yeah.
Okay. We'll call for the vote. The superintendent's contract calls for the action by the board, the acceptance of his resignation. So that's the reason for this motion this evening. So all those in favor of accepting Dr. Clayton Wilcox's resignation, please raise your right hand. 6-0. Thank you.
Thank you.
And now we're back to the superintendent's report.
Good timing.
Yeah. You guys came up here early, so you must have wanted to rush that. Thank you very much. It's my pleasure this evening to present Derek Root, who's our Chief Technology Officer, and Dr. Mike Kahanek, who's our Supervisor for School Improvement. They're going to talk to you about the digital learning plan that this board enthusiastically approved earlier this year, talk to you a little bit about kind of the state of the state, and they'll be open to any questions that you have for them. I think this will be one of those reports that you'll probably want to have at least on a semi-annual basis going forward, but I'm going to turn it over to you. Mike, is that right? All right.
Good evening, President Ms. Williams and Vice President Mr. Stauffer and fellow board members. Just to give you an update for the new board members, we did approve the digital learning plan last year. I believe it was December 15th or 16th, somewhere in that range. And for the last year, we've been very, very busy trying to bring this on board for what we wanted to do for Washington County Public Schools. As a reminder and just kind of a indicator of where it's framed, the digital learning plan for Washington County Public Schools was founded in Future Ready. We are, Dr. Wilcox had joined over 3,000 superintendents across the country who signed up for Future Ready. And Future Ready, its primary goal is to bring equitable access to all students, specifically internet access and resource access. As a school system, prior to the digital learning plan, we did have in excess of over 20,000 devices. However, the equity of those devices was sporadic. Some schools had much more resources than others. So the digital learning plan, with the board's support, we're happy to provide that we definitely move forward in an equitable manner And today we're here to show you some of the outcomes of our efforts and our next steps and directions on where we're going. Today's presentation will briefly cover each one of these seven areas. These are the seven gears in which Future Ready measures its success, in which it kind of grounds us into where we're going. It's heavily supported with the research and the direction of national legislation. The first slide we'd like to show you is on the curriculum and instruction and assessment. One of the very first things we did when the digital learning plan was approved was we built a new digital portal for all staff members to use. This portal has the access to all the resources for teachers, everything from professional development to even updates for their individual departments, to access to human resources and everything else. This portal, which was launched in August, these analytics reflect from September on, and I'm not gonna read each of the analytics, but you can see that we've had quite a bit of activity. So we've had well over 53,000 hits in this portal from our teaching staff and our community, and it's going up every time. Quick Links is obviously a favorite because it accesses everything from the time card to your email system to the evaluation system. But however, you will see shortly behind that is the essential curriculum, departments, and professional learning in which they're all housed in this portal. And that started our communication link for teachers and support. One of the very first gears of the Future Ready was curriculum and instruction, so we'll speak briefly there. I know you've been briefed recently by Dr. Pugh on the blueprint, the essential blueprint and the curriculum blueprint, which has been created. It is in digital form, it is on this portal. And instructionally, we as a school system, we are focused on teachers being able to use to personalize education in alignment with powerful practices and current research founded in a Google Suite. As a Google Suite district, we are specifically trying to gear teachers towards using that resource for all students. All students do have email access through Google. All students also have Google Suite access, Google Drive, Google Docs, in which they do a lot of their collaboration and their work through the Google Education. To share with you some of the progress we've had in this instructional component.
To back up some of the discussion that Dr. Kahanek is sharing with you, I put together just a few analytics from the Google Drive. And pardon the glasses on and off. I get to see this or you, but not both. So you'll see I ran these numbers from September of this year, sort of the beginning of the real equitable distribution of equipment to students. You'll see that at the beginning of the school year, our students had stored in their Google Drive 7,673 gigabytes of information. That's quite a bit. If you look at your average iPhone, it holds about 32. But since that time, by the time we went into Christmas break and came back, that number grew to 12,171, which represents a 63% increase in online storage by our students. So you can see that they really are heavily utilizing the Google Suite. Again, the number of files our students own and have created out there, beginning of the year, 2 million files, 73,095. Currently, 4,313,000. Of course, these numbers are about a week old, so I wouldn't be surprised to see that at 4.5 million already at the rate of growth. Again, that represents a 48% increase in usage. Lastly, from the Google Suite, this number represents shared links. So what this means is when a student is collaborating with another student, or a student is collaborating with their teacher digitally and online, our numbers of shared links went from 2.94 million to 4.42 million in that same time period, which again represented a 66% increase in students collaborating online digitally.
One of the big focuses for the digital learning plan was also assessment. We know that we wanted students to have equal access, and we wanted to minimize the impacts of assessment. I'm sure you don't have to look far to see the conversations going nationwide about over-testing or the impact of testing on student learning and teacher time. We are happy to share that since the one-to-one initiative has been launched, all students now can take their own assessments. They are taking them in their own classrooms. In the prior, we used to have to collapse classrooms. Technology teachers had to be relocated and actually teach without technology while students use their technology for testing. All those things are now a thing behind us. Alternative bell schedules for weeks on ends do no longer exist. And we can attest, and we have tested and are testing entire grade levels at a single shot, where before we didn't really have the equipment to do so and handle. We also wanted to briefly give you some direction on where it's going, because when we talk next steps towards the end of this presentation on where we're going to go as a system, with your blessing and support, we wanted to share some of the current things that are going on. So blended learning is an opportunity that is growing across Maryland. It's for students to take classes in concert online with teacher. For blended learning, it means that in excess of 20% of the student instruction is actually face-to-face with a teacher. So there is face-to-face time, and then there's also virtual time and online time. Currently, you can see by the next graph that we have a significant number of students already in blended learning. These are the number of credits that are given for students who want to take a course. For original credit would be in blue. The orange is for students who are doing repeat credits, or students, so which means they did not successfully succeed in a class with the traditional instruction, so they chose as an option to do it blended to try and make that credit up and gain that credit back. What's interesting to see is that we've had a very strong online presence already as a system. The one-to-one initiative is only growing it. You can see that in 2015-2016, there was blended versus traditional was 47.8% with blended enrollments. However, if you just advance to where we are right now, we're at 57.1% are blended enrollments. So our blended learning is definitely going up. And if you break it down by course, you can actually see the courses are way going up. Now the green represents an entire year of blended learning opportunities for our students. The purple, which you can see is almost as much as the green, is actually only one semester. So if you double the purple, just thinking ahead, theoretically and conceptually, you'll see that the blended learning is significantly growing at a rate for our students, and they're doing very well in it and preferring it.
Okay, so in support of any decent blended learning initiative or digital learning plan or whatever the name you choose to assign to the program is a robust infrastructure. So I wanted to give a little update on where we are with the infrastructure. We currently have three primary internet connections that feed and connect us to the outside world. Two of those are 1 gigabyte links, which are our primary networks, and they load balance and protect each other. So if one goes down, we shift traffic the other direction. We also have a third link, a tertiary link, that we make available for our guest traffic. And what that does is keeps our guests isolated from us a little bit, which helps provide some extra security, and it gives them a path out in and out of the system that does not affect student learning. So the speeds on those networks, I'm a little slow here, pardon me. The speeds on those networks are about 1 gigabit, as I said. The Future Ready recommends that we have 100 to 1,000 gigabits or megabits of data connection per 1,000 students. Currently, WCPS is meeting the minimum recommendation. We haven't actually gone after the higher levels of that recommendation, and part of that is a cost strategy. As I get into a few graphs that I'm going to show you here in a few minutes, you'll see why. But we're working right now, actually got word today that the equipment has been installed for what's called a burstable connection. What that means is we have and pay for a particular amount of data bandwidth, but should we reach that limit, we can burst beyond it. Our providers will then only charge us when we use that additional bandwidth. And as I get into these additional slides, you'll see exactly why we want to take that approach. What you see here represents last year in our data bandwidth usage. You can see right around May, when we started to deploy into the early stages of the digital learning plan, a considerable jump in the amount of bandwidth that our system is using on a daily basis. As we jump forward to the next graph, this shows our bandwidth usage from September again through December of this year. Now you'll see that graph spike all up and down, even though it's over the course of a month. And the reason I put this up there is to show you that even though we have 2 gigabits of available bandwidth, on an average we're using only about 10% of that. And the reason for that is because we're closed at night. We're not a 24-hour business. We're not open on the weekend so much. So we don't use that bandwidth. Again, why we go after the burstable type of bandwidth and not the always-on bandwidth that, say, an online retailer would need. Now, following the digital learning plan, you can see what an average morning starts to look like in a school. We hum along at about 250 megabits worth of usage, and then all of a sudden 6 a.m. comes along, kids start coming online, teachers start coming online, you see that traffic really ramp up. and it comes up to near the peak of what's available to us. That 2,000 represents two of the 2.3 that I said was available earlier. But then as the day progresses, you'll see us coming through lunchtime where we drop off pretty heavily for a while, and then on into 2:50, 3 o'clock p.m., where you see the bandwidth really start to fall off again. By 5 o'clock p.m., we're back down at that lower number, and a lot of those numbers are generated by my staff doing work and updating things at night. So you get a good idea of, we have these spikes in bandwidth during the day and what we're doing to maintain the connections. Now, to use the devices, we have to manage them. We have a tool called Jamf Pro. It's our primary mobile device management system. We have primary and secondary system administrators that run it. We have system technicians that are deployed out into the field that are trained in field level support. Every school has designated a primary resource. Sometimes it's a media specialist, maybe a lead teacher. That resource is trained and continues to be trained in the proper purchase and deployment of apps to the iPad in their facility. They don't always have to come to IT for support. They can do some self-service on their own. Makes the process go a lot faster for them. And we will continue to train the media specialists, who really are the front line of technology support in the school every day. Our wireless network is available in all of our buildings, including CES and A20. We have been working on enhancements that are underway this year. When those enhancements are completed, we will have a wireless access point in every classroom, something we did not start the year out with. That will allow enhanced access to every student, even those that might be using multiple devices simultaneously. We also enhance the gathering spaces, media centers, gymnasiums, areas where large crowds of people might come together, either for a presentation, something going on in the school, a parents' night, whatever it is. We want to make sure that we are well covered throughout the building. Of course, with any network infrastructure, we need to worry about data and privacy, especially in today's environment. So one of our first lines of defense for the students is a system called the Lightspeed Rocket. That system is our content filtering system. It helps us mitigate risk of unwanted contact delivery to kids. It's basically the filter keeping objectionable material off of our iPads. Lightspeed is a hardware-based solution, but provides us the ability to create white or black lists of our own, which means if something's being blocked erroneously, we can go and we can make a fix to make that better. Or if something isn't being blocked that we're finding along the way, then we can go ahead and shut that off. The great thing about Lightspeed, they have a huge market share in the education space, but they allow us to filter the information that comes to an iPad, not just here on our network, but beyond the logical bounds of our network. So when a kid goes home, those same filters that they receive in school apply to their iPad at home. And I know that was a critical part of what the board was interested in, and we've been able to make that happen this year. Secondly, we have an enhanced firewall system. It improves filtering and dynamic threat detection. It's got some intrusion prevention to keep the bad guys from hacking our core systems back here. It's got cloud-based analysis for us. We can filter content by region. Some political parties may wish they could have done that this year. And it has some expanded throughput, so it can go a little faster than the existing systems. Some of the additional privacy capabilities we have through our Jamf Pro MDM, we can lock a lost or stolen device. We can track a lost or stolen device. We can display an error message or play sounds on a lost or stolen device. And if all else fails, we can erase the content on a lost or stolen device. We also have what's called an activation lock installed. So if someone were to steal one of our devices, sell it somewhere, that person goes to activate it, it's locked. It might as well be a paperweight. It really doesn't provide any good. All deterrents to theft on the systems. Mike?
We continue to do our community partnerships. We have the E-Rate still going on, in which the AeroHive expansion, in which we are currently moving forward with one AeroHive for every classroom in our Washington County Public Schools. We still have partnerships with all the community centers, which do offer the free Wi-Fi, local libraries, and YMCA, and we do maintain communications with them as well. And we currently have the continued partnership with Antietam Cable for reduced rates for internet, currently, which is in excess of over 150 homes in our system are accessing that. The professional learning is really gaining a lot of mileage. I don't know how familiar you are with it, but in the past year or so, We've developed a lot of modules for teachers and training modules that are online. I think some board members have even accessed them in how to use Google and all those other things that were created by WCPS teachers, and they've been well received. We pick the experts in the field, and we create those training modules in which staff can access. What's new, though, is this month, which is launching, is which teachers can actually do the PD anywhere, anytime. So they can actually do the training modules in a Google Classroom at their own pace and submit the evidences of learning and access the teacher by a certain due date, and we give them credit for completing the course. We currently have over about 60 teachers enrolled in the courses that we just put out this past week for Google Calendar, Google Classroom, Google Docs, and Google Drive, in which the teachers are signing up, and they are definitely coming fast towards the hoop for that. They're definitely welcoming that opportunity. It's up there. To give you an idea. Oops, it went back on me, didn't it? Here's some statistics of the teachers and the other professional adults in our system, including administrators who have accessed. These are the thousands of minutes in which you can see that the teachers and staff have accessed professional development anytime, anywhere. This is prior to it actually being organized or framed in a course in which it's supported with professional development funds. This is purely on teachers' own interest. The neat thing about the training modules is they are set up for piece by piece based on skill. Most of the videos are all within less than 5 minutes. That's kind of a requirement and a goal for us. And all of them are very skill specific so that teachers can go into exactly what they need. For example, if they know 80% of Google Docs, but they don't know, for example, how to share something, they can go and just watch that file or that module on that. And what you see is the individual breakdowns of the watch time on videos. You can see that the average video is about, watch time is about 2 minutes and 47 seconds. And that's actually not too far from our creation rate or what we try to create them to keep them right on point so that they're very specific to what the teacher needs. You can see the number of views and the watch time is in excess in just this past year. With only 4 to 5 months of PD, you can see that we've had over 17,000 minutes of watch time from Washington County Public School staff.
Okay, so how are we doing on the budget? I don't want to read through the original slide here, but I wanted to talk a little bit about how we've deployed our iPads and how they're being used. To date, we have approximately 22,000 iPads deployed. This is inclusive of the digital learning plan, Title I, special education grants, and other targeted programs in the system. I pulled some data on this again over the month of December, and during that period of time, 20,434 of those iPads have checked in and been used within the last 30 days. That's, of course, about 93% of our iPads that have been in use every day. We take into account that we try to maintain a 2 to 3% inventory of spare iPads at any given time, so what you see there is really all but about 6% of our iPads are in continuous use in the system. I think that's just a fantastic number. Sorry, I forgot to advance that. iCoverage was another program that came in with the digital learning plan. For those of you that aren't familiar with iCoverage, it's there to help our families protect themselves from an expensive damage or loss with the iPad. A majority of our families have chosen to participate in iCoverage. To date, iCoverage has provided enough funding to make sure that any damaged or lost iPads have been able to be replaced or repaired under the iCoverage program. And I still continue to have people signing up for iCoverage, which is great. IT, the Department of Instruction, and Finance are collaborating on logistical and operational management and iCoverage. What that means is we're trying to get that out of the hands of the school so they don't have to worry about it. iPad comes in that's broken. Dr. Kanick and I have worked out a system where they fill out a short form, open a trouble ticket, send us the iPad. We take care of the rest with the iPads and the tracking of that. So again, trying to ease the burden of what's going on out in the schools. IT staffing, as many of you know, we've had a big reconfiguration. The new positions and staff are closely aligned and have been closely aligned all along with the digital learning plan. We've taken the technical support staff and moved them closer to their end users. So the available field technicians are now housed out in schools and not here in this building anymore. So those field technicians are getting about an hour a day more time in their schools because they're not coming here and driving to a school. They're going straight to their school. And of course, the board approved a couple extra positions, so we have more of them. And we've had several principals who graciously volunteered to create spaces for them in the schools. We have them clustered, and if any time you're interested in how that cluster is set up, I'd be happy to provide some information on that. Centralized Technology Support Center is in place. We've got an upgraded help desk down there with triple the number of staff that used to be on there, taking probably quadruple the number of calls they used to get. We've also got data analytics and software development capabilities that did not exist here 1 year ago. Those are already hitting the ground running. And we have a focused online testing support and training person. And again, her primary job is to make sure our schools are ready, our iPads are ready, all in an effort to reduce the impact of testing on the classroom. So, from a budget perspective, we are on track, on course. We recommend that we stay the course and really don't need to monkey with it too much. I think we're doing really well. Up next, for the following school year, we're looking at Antietam Academy to outfit that building with iPads. Also, Washington County Technical High School. And then we really need to go after the teachers because the teachers are using outdated iPads already. Apple, as a matter of fact, announced this year that they will no longer provide software updates to the iPad 2s. So we got to start getting those things filtered out of the system.
In regards to supporting teachers in learning, again, we want to grow the Anytime Anywhere Learning for teachers. We currently have a lot of other modules that are in development right now. We plan to launch more in February in regards to help teachers guide in using the digital tools to do formative assessment. Real-time differentiation for students is really a big focus for us moving forward. And this is a quote that a teacher recently just sent in, which I just found was really powerful for the teacher to send a quote in before. This was just at the launch of the enrollment for the opportunity to enroll in the courses. So they do definitely prefer or like the online anytime enrollment and the ability to do it at flexible availabilities. The next steps for Anytime Anywhere Learning we also want to grow is for students. Piggybacking on where we talked about with the virtual blended learning opportunities, this is something that's really unique that's coming to Washington County Public Schools starting this month.
Sorry, my fault.
That's okay. Starting this month, we will start the virtual Twilight. Virtual Twilight is you're familiar with the virtual high school over at Western Heights Middle School. We have morphed that into supporting more of our virtual and blended learning opportunities for students. Virtual Twilight specifically is an opportunity for students at Hancock, Williamsport, Boonesboro, and North Hagerstown High School. They will be taking courses after school, right after school, at satellite locations, specifically Foundations of Technology and Health. And I think, Mr. Gesford, you've referenced this before about the opportunity for students to open up holes in their schedule so they can take more with these fine arts. And this is exactly what the target is for this goal, is to let those students be able to, many of those students will be advanced students, for example, that want to open up so they can have more band or other opportunities. So Hancock, and we didn't also, most of the blended learning opportunities we had prior to this have been offered at the evening high school program, which is over at Antietam Academy. We wanted to take them out to the satellite location so the students can do it right after school, easier for transportation, easier for access. In addition to doing that, we will be streaming the class from one school to the other. The teacher will rotate between the two schools. The reason for that, the very clear purpose for that, is to test our streaming capabilities and our streaming abilities with the technologies using Swivel Technologies. What we would like to offer in the fall is virtual daytime. And in virtual daytime, what we're looking to do is to help fill students in some advanced courses, fill some empty seats in advanced courses for students across the county. So if Mr. Bickford, for example, was teaching a foreign language that is unique to one school, for example, Italian, and other students wanted to pipe in on that, we could actually have you stream to other students who could take it in common areas within their other schools. We're looking to span that across the school system with other advanced programs for highly motivated students, understanding that our county is unique in its course offerings, in that we have some schools that are very small that have limited course offerings, and we have some schools that are very large that have tremendous course offerings. And if we can bring that equity to all students across Washington County Public Schools without them having to leave their community, we believe we'll all be better served.
And with that wraps up our presentation. We'll open it up to questions if anybody has any.
The virtual Twilight going pretty fast. What are Where are the satellite locations? I'm not following that.
I'm sorry. Satellite locations are Williamsport High School, Hancock High School, Boonesboro High School, and North Hagerstown High School.
We can put those in a list and send them off to the board, the greater board, if you're interested. We'll put those in a list and send them off to the greater board if you're interested.
Mr. Gessman.
Yes. Question for you. On the iPad 2s, you said that they're old and they're having to be replaced. How many are we going to be replacing?
It would basically be one for every teacher in the system. So we'd be looking at around 1,500, I think we have, about 1,500, roughly, without pulling an actual number for you. But just, you can take that as being pretty close.
How old are the ones that we have, we just gave?
So student iPads are all of a newer generation, iPad 4 and beyond. The iPad 2s were collected as part of a redistribution of the technology. As it was decided early on that they were not going to be compatible with everything that we needed our students to be able to do. It turned out that there were enough of those iPads available at the beginning of the year that Dr. Wilcox was able to say, hey, let's get one in every teacher's hands. It wasn't something that had been part of the original plan, but it was sort of a bonus that we could get them rolling forward with that, with the long-term goal of making sure teachers had a similar device to what students are using in the classroom.
Okay. So how many of those are, when are we going to be getting rid of those? I mean, are they something we're going to be doing in the next, you know, school year or?
Yeah, it would fall into the next budget season. There's nothing left in this budget season to do. So it's something we'd be looking at into the next budget season.
About 1,500 of those.
Yeah.
And that was built in, Mr. Gessford, into the digital learning plan. And in addition, it's actually about 1,800, but I would also piggyback that with the understanding that Antietam Academy and Tech High still operate off the iPad 2s. I don't know if the board recalls or not, but last spring, I believe it was around May, we were notified by Pearson that the iPad 2s were not going to be supported for testing. So we went ahead and we accelerated the digital learning plan in some capacities to North Hagerstown High School, Williamsport Elementary, and I think there was one more, in which we removed those iPad 2s out of those schools because Tech High obviously has a strong technological support. They can do testing really on many of the devices they have in the school. So we went ahead and accelerated those schools, and so now what we're looking to do is still in, it was completely identified. The iPad 2s were planning on being phased out in the digital learning plan at the end of this year anyway, because they were reaching about 6 years of life.
Yep. That's good to know. On the ones that we are, from the beginning of the year, I think we started that insurance program where parents could pay, and how many have we just can't replace because they're damaged or lost or stolen?
I thought you might ask that question, so I had them pull the numbers for me last week. As of last week, we had a little shy of 24 that have been damaged beyond repair. Those were ones that, you know, I think we had one got ran over by a car, you know, like there was just only so much you can do.
Good numbers.
But it's only about 24, it's a really small number. Now, on any given day, we probably see 100 of them get put into lost mode. It's a mode that the schools can put them into. So when a kid says, I can't find my iPad, they can put it in lost mode. We turn on the tracking device, and usually by the end of that day or sometimes into the next day, we find one. We found one on a bus just on Friday. You know, a kid put in lost mode, got on the bus next Monday morning, and there it was. You know,
so that program's working, that they're not being taken to New York and just around here. So,
it's just shy of 24. I was 21 or 22 that she sent me back. If I have my phone with
me,
fantastic. I can tell
you. I'm glad to hear that.
Yeah.
And I'd also reiterate that the tablet and the fact that we can have a protective case as opposed to a laptop that not so protective has really lended itself well to us in regards to wear and tear from an adolescent.
Yeah, they take a pretty good beating.
So you have on here on the inventory 2,200 iPads deployed and 2,436 iPads have indicated use. Do you know where the rest of those are? Do we have a good inventory of it? There are different schools.
I know exactly where they are. It's just those are the ones that have been used. Now, we probably have 80 of them in this building that get used for professional development. And again, the schools maintain between a 2-3% spare cache of iPads. So when a kid walks in and it's broken, we don't want them to go the whole day with lost instruction. We hand them another iPad, and take the broken one and send it off to get fixed. If you recall, a few weeks back, I was before you all asking for about 300 more iPads that we funded out of the eye coverage funds. And that was to shore up those numbers a little bit, because there were a few schools that didn't have enough spares due to enrollment fluctuations through the year. So we can tell you specifically where they are through the mobile device management system, and basically when the last time someone used it and who that person was.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Good job.
Thank you. Ms. Fisher?
If there was no original plan for teachers to have the iPads 2s, but then because there was enough, we decided to give them to them, then doesn't that mean that the replacement of those is not in our original funding plan?
Well, they weren't. Because Mike was able to accelerate the plan last year and we had these additional iPads, also considering that we get our numbers shored up through other means like Title I, we were able to push the boundaries of the plan a little bit into teachers' hands. Also, since this plan has been developed, Apple has come out with a couple of really exciting technologies that aren't available to teachers on their Macs. Apple Classroom is one of the best ones that I would love to show you all sometime. That allows teachers to real-time see what students are doing on their iPads, push individualized assignments down. So in the initial plan, I think you're correct that the numbers for teachers to have them all weren't there. What I can do is say I can sit here and make a really strong argument that now that they have them, we should try to make sure to keep them up to date if we can.
Okay, I'm just concerned about a very, very tight budget period.
Absolutely,
coming up.
And no one's more concerned about that than I. So I keep a really close eye almost on a daily basis of how our deployments are going and making sure that the students always come first with making sure they have the equipment that they need.
Thank you.
I have some other questions, but I'll put them in an email because after I have time to really look over this. And
absolutely, and if you need an additional briefing, I'm always happy to share.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask a question about the bar graph, that's the original credit and repeat credit. First of all, it may be the lateness of the hour, but I looked at that graph and that very tall blue bar there, and I'm looking at EHS, and I'm thinking to myself, which high school starts with an E, which high school starts with an E, which high school starts with an E.
It's the evening high school.
Yes, I figured that out.
Program out of Antietam Academy.
Right.
Where's Williamsport on that? WH at the end is kind of cut off, I noticed.
It doesn't have a bar? Does that mean that it's not doing anything there, or?
Yeah, my understanding, I'll have to double check that one.
Okay.
I would like to get back
to that. But my question was, seeing that the original credit is high there at Evening High School and at North Hagerstown High School, can you give us an idea of what kind of courses or what courses are being done for that original credit? I'm just curious to know because I...
No, absolutely. And in all fairness, and most of them are general credit courses.
Uh-huh.
So they're not the advanced courses. They're not honors. There's also... So you have many different reasons students attend Evening High School. One is to repeat a course because they obviously didn't succeed in it.
Right.
And they're behind an account. Another one could be purely disciplinary. We do have students that remotely attend the Evening High School program mm-hmm. that come in on the side, they do the computer lab, and they take the classes remotely and then with a teacher, and then they leave. So it's a broad range, but I would say it is not advanced coursework that is being housed there. It is currently just general ed credits.
Part of English 9.
Right.
English 9.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So, and that's one of the reasons we also want to grow the Virtual Brooks program, because we believe that while it's great for remediation and supporting struggling learners, it also has tremendous capacity for advanced learners.
For advanced learners, that's great.
You're going to check on the Williamsport High thing?
I will.
From the end there? Cause
absolutely.
I'm interested in that one. I taught there.
Absolutely.
Looking forward to hearing more about the virtual daytime and virtual twilight programs that you're getting.
We're excited about it as
implementing.
Well.
Implementing. Look forward to hearing a presentation about that later. Any other questions for Mr. Root or Mr. Kohanek? Thank you so much, gentlemen.
Appreciate Thank you. We appreciate
it.
Your time.
Thank you, guys.
Okay. That brings us to the superintendent's update, Dr. Wilcox.
I just want to thank the board for approving my resignation effective March 13th, and I will have at a later meeting a longer comment for the community. But again, thank you very much. And I also just wanted to take one moment of personal privilege. Earlier this evening, we had a young student who was here, young Mr. Mason, but he didn't really introduce his principal. And most of you know Carl Stark, but Mr. Stark is one of those great principals that oftentimes goes kind of below the radar, and people don't really say all the great things about what he does. He is not only a consummate professional, but he's one of those principals whose school just continues to do great things, whose teachers choose to stay with him over the long duration. So I just wanted to take a minute and say to my neighbor, thank you very much. And probably more than anyone else in this district, I rely on his weather forecast before opening or closing schools in the winter. It's a passion of his, and he's probably the most informed weather person outside of Lou Scally that we have in this community.
True. Thank you, Dr. Wilcox. And now we'll move on to personnel action. And Dr. Wilcox, I understand you're going to handle that this evening.
I am. And earlier this evening, we discussed some personnel recommendations. We're looking for the board's approval of those recommendations.
Have a motion for approval.
So move.
Okay. So we have a motion for approval of the personnel recommendations. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. So all those in favor of the approval of the personnel actions as presented, please raise your right hand. 6-0. All right. Thank you. That brings us to reports to the board. Would you like to start us off down there, Ms. Greenwald?
Sure.
Thank you.
The Washington County Association of Student Councils met last week at Northern Middle School. The highlight of our meeting was a What's Up Doc panel where we had Dr. Kahanek, Dr. Pugh, and Dr. Michael attend and answer questions on a plethora of topics such as technology, superintendent search, just a bunch of student-related issues, and they were able to give really well-informed and concise answers. We will not be meeting in February.
Thank you. We haven't had any committees meet, and we don't have a schedule yet.
Continue.
Mr. Bickford?
Oh, nothing for me.
Okay, we're not on board member comments. We're just on committee reports. Okay, so I wanted to report on a couple MABE things. As mentioned earlier, I attended the MABE Legislative Committee meeting that met on January 9th, and there was a voluminous packet in your Friday delivery that was given out to members of the committee. Items such as the report from the Kerwin Commission, retirement costs, school facility funding issues, the Knott Commission, special education issues. I mean, it's just a lot of information there for you to read at your leisure. Mrs. Harshman and I will be attending the MABE Conference Committee meeting on January 19th. And if any of you have suggestions for the 2017 MABE Conference, please let me know. We'll be looking for suggestions for keynote speakers, topics for workshop sessions, or any other ways to improve the conference and make it a even better professional development experience for board members across the state than it is. And I think as conferences go, it's an excellent one. And I've had the opportunity in my years of teaching to have attended some excellent conferences. And this is by far one of my favorites. Anyone else have anything with regard to committees?
Mike, I spoke to Dr. Michael, and he would like to go ahead and set up a meeting on January 24th. The time will be announced, but we have a lot to discuss.
So that's the Facilities Committee on January 24th?
Yes.
Okay. Righty, thank you. And then that brings us to consideration of future agenda items. Anyone have any suggestions for future agenda items? No? Okay, then we'll go right to board member comments. Mr. Ridenour, would you like to start
nothing
us off this,
this
evening? Nothing? Mrs. Fisher?
I have nothing. It's been a long enough day as it is.
Not a thing.
Nothing.
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 I actually do have a comment, yeah.
All right.
I would just like to briefly comment on the digital learning plan update. I'm probably the only person on this board who gets to see it in action every day. And I can definitely say that everything they reported on is what I see as a student in the school system. We have had testing for PARC, and I can tell you, as someone who wasn't taking the PARC exam, I didn't even know it was happening because we didn't have this crazy bell change. We didn't have a crazy schedule change. And it was a really awesome change from last year and past years when it was a really big disruption. Also, I can attest to the value in Google Classroom and Google Slides, especially in one circumstance where I had a teacher that went on a long period of leave. And Google Classroom really aided us in communication. They were able to post videos of their own and connect us to YouTube videos that they thought were beneficial. And we were really able to stay in constant communication with that teacher, and it really saved like a lot of us. And I don't think this would have been possible without every student in our class having an iPad, no matter where they came from or their socioeconomic status. So I'm just so grateful that I'm in the school system that has taken such a large leap forward. And so thank you and congratulations to the whole team. This is great work.
Thank you for your comments very much. As Mrs. Fisher has mentioned, it has been a very long day, and I want to thank you for a very good day. I appreciate the work that we have accomplished today and the way that we accomplished it, and I would like to give a very special thank you to Mrs. Cheryl Steiner, who stuck with us through some very long meetings and with her great note-taking as she was taking our minutes. So thank you, Mrs. Steiner. And with that, if you have no comments,
no.
Superintendent, we'll adjourn the meeting.